almost a former PhD student when we graduated in, or not, yes, in December. So we studied in Ecole Normale Supérieure in Paris. He works in power systems, like our power systems. His advisor is a theoretical mathematician, so you should expect a few questions there. But I think he will give the talk from a higher level.
Yeah. So anything which is not clear, we can use the board here, not depending on the slides. And if it is too mathematical, I can skip and move forward. That is also
so why is
because I could not skip all the equations completely. I tried to.
Why is he in Madeira? So he's working in Smile. That's part of the Prisma, the startup. He'll be with us until February. So you'll see the talk, and then if you want to talk about a bit of mathematics later, I think he's the right person to go. Without further ado, I have 20 minutes.
20?
No, just kidding. 40.
Okay. So my talk is high level on projects that I have done during my PhD with using optimization and control tools for solving different problems in power systems. And why these problems exist is because power system itself is undergoing a change in two directions, how people consume electricity and how power is generated. So because of this, there are a lot of problems happening, a lot of challenges which are appearing. And these challenges can be looked at as opportunities for players who are active, like consumers who are active to change their consumption behavior can gain something out of it. And similarly, there are producers, and there are a lot of subsidies and opportunities given in terms of carbon dioxide reduction. So there are opportunities in both directions, but because of this change, there are a lot of things have to be redesigned. So what I'm doing in my this presentation, and which is a summary of my PhD thesis, is using storage as a tool to solve these problems. So let me clarify that there are many other ways these problems can be solved, and I'm using storage in this. So batteries normally are very expensive, so you would like to use it as good as possible because they have a limited life and they die out after some time, and so you need to take care of the battery health when you design control and optimization. So on high level, if I divide the key contributions in my thesis, they can be categorized into four sections. First, I'll deal with the energy arbitrage problem. I'll define what arbitrage is and what the contributions we have made. Second, in which I have done some problem solving in context of Madeira, is co-optimization, not using just for one application for the battery, but several applications at the same time. Because both the first two applications are more relevant for consumers in low voltage networks, or maybe some sort of consumers, maybe in high voltage, but consumers. But the third part is in context of the utility, in which profit making is not the main goal. Like for the DSO in Madeira, what is interesting for them is to how to increase the reliability of the network. Rather than making profit, they also have to take care of the reliability of the network. And fourth, which is kind of a summary and some takeaways that we have done in the three sections, integrating that with the health aspect of the battery. Because as I mentioned, that the battery in itself is a source of energy which is depleting over time. Like all batteries have a limited life and a very high cost. So you would like to take care of the health of the battery. So that is the fourth. I'll start with the first one. So the motivation of energy arbitrage is electricity prices are varying all over the world. In fact, in Madeira, you have two level time of use, which means that consuming electricity at any one time is not the same as consuming at any other time, which means that it is beneficial for the consumers to shift their consumption. And that is what is basically energy arbitrage is, because suppose the consumers add a storage, then they can discharge the battery during the prices are high and charge it when the prices are low. And in effect, they are making some profit. And that is possible because electricity prices, which traditionally used to be fixed, are varying over time. and cost of storage is drastically reducing. So I'm not going to talk about it in detail here, but over the last 10 years, the prices of batteries have degraded by almost 300% for lithium-ion batteries. So in this section of my talk, I'm using tools such as convex optimization, linear programming, Lagrangian theory, strong duality theory, and I'm using MPC, model predictive control, in context of, say, a dumb forecast model. I'm using an autoregressive forecast model in sync with model predictive control for real-time implementation. I'll talk about it. So before we actually go into the contribution, let's try to understand the problem itself. So let's assume this is a consumer and they are consuming some amount of energy. Now they have a rooftop PV and they're generating, and at some times, consider initially there is no battery, so there may be some times in which the generation itself is higher than the consumption, and they have to supply back to the grid. Everything is fine, but it is highly dependent on how the electricity price is varying over the day that you would like to take decisions. Now, suppose in case I have a battery here, then the mode of operation that the battery should operate will be governed by the price of electricity, which is over the day, solar generation and consumer load. And since the battery itself has a finite capacity, the capacity will decide whether I should charge or discharge. So arbitrage is totally governed by profit maximization. So in this case, the optimization objective function is pretty clear, because profit is directly the cost function which you try to maximize in this case. So if I do the formulation in terms of maths, so before you go see below, I would like you to see the title of the slide, which says net arbitrage, energy arbitrage with net metering 1.0. So 1.0 is our net metering policy, which was applied in California initially, which stated that price of electricity for buying and selling at any time are the same. So if the prices are varying over time, so buying price and selling price are varying at the same rate. In that case, apparently the optimization becomes very simple. And suppose Zi is my load and renewable generation, so my optimization function becomes completely independent of the load variations. And the only thing that I need to take care of is the charging and discharging states of the battery. And you don't need to look at the equations. What I'll show here is, this is the cost function. And in optimization, there is something called as convexity. So what does convexity means is, if you can prove convexity of your function, of your cost function, and of all the constraints that you are applying your cost function on, then you can apply convex optimization. And what is the benefit of convex optimization is, you can guarantee that the solution is unique and optimal. You are not having any suboptimal results. So we here show that the cost function itself has a convex structure, so which is essential, because we'll guarantee optimality using this structure. The second thing that we claim is the optimal arbitrage under this compensation strategy has a threshold-based structure. So mu, in economic terms, is a shadow price. Here we have like sum of all the accumulated Lagrange multipliers over time, and if my electricity price with the function of charging and discharging efficiency is correlated with the shadow price at that instant, based on that I can decide my charging and discharging states. So X min means discharging at the maximum rate, and X max means the charging at the maximum rate. So as you can see, when shadow price has some equality with the discharging cost and the charging cost, then I don't have a unique solution. I rather have an envelope of solution which has an upper and lower bound, and I need to pick up an optimal value, which is not so trivial, because and actually I'm not talking about the algorithm here itself, but the key takeaway is the optimal action for the battery has a threshold-based structure. So these are the thresholds explicitly categorized here. But as we go to net metering 2.0, so previously I was talking about net metering 1.0, which in which buying and selling price are the same. Now California has initiated a different policy, which is similar or interesting for Madeira too, is selling price is not the same as buying price. They can be something different. But there's a condition that the selling price is always lower than the buying price. So in Madeira, you have zero selling price, which satisfies this condition, in which your battery storage, battery charging and discharging actions are not independent of the load, but rather dependent on the load. So if in that case, the cost function still has the convexity structure, provided you choose the decision variable mentioned here. So if the decision variables are flipped, then basically, or the notations are flipped, then we don't have the convexity for the same problem. So I would like to pause and if any questions here. Just as you can expect that for this case, the cost function was only having two slopes. So the thresholds had like some limited number of values. In this case, now we have two sets of such equations with more number of slopes changing. So convexity is there because the slope is increasing as you progress, as xi value is increasing. So that's why you can claim convexity. In both these cases, the slope is progressive, is increasing as you progress in xi, the optimization variable. So in this case, the thresholds have much more number of values. In fact, for this, we have four different conditions with 17 different thresholds decided by the sign of Zi, which is the net load of the consumer. Okay, not going into the algorithm, not going into the threshold. Just comparing our results with some benchmarks. So the first case, we solved this optimization problem using a standard convex optimization tool. Second is we formulate, and which again is the first of its kind, formulating this problem as a linear programming problem. And the third is what we propose. So the blue line has no load, so it's just controlling of the battery over variation of prices. The red has load, and similarly for the other cases. So you can see, as my number of samples increasing, our algorithm beats linear programming and convex optimization by several orders. So which means that it's simpler, like linear programming is a standard. If you beat linear programming, it's amazing. So in this case, we happen to do that. Okay, now, again, something which is very interesting for us is, so this is just a result. I'm not giving any background like how these results are created, because this is again, so we have three batteries and we have three MPC algorithms. And what we see here is, so that there is like day ahead prices. This is in context of California. So they have day ahead prices they generate every day. Then you have the simple ARIMA model in red, and you have a scenario-based model predictive control in which you have thousands of scenarios. Based on that, you try to minimize or maximize expected cost, and based on that, you take a decision. So the black line for a slow battery is almost as close to blue line, and the blue line is the deterministic. So when you try to optimize something with everything known, that blue is the highest that you can get, and the black is almost close to the blue for most of the cases, except for the last one, in which the batteries are very fast. What does it mean is, as my ramp rate, ramping capability of the battery, like if you take a hydro turbine, which is also a battery, and if you take a flywheel, which is also a battery, so the chances of inaccuracies or information inaccuracies are more grave in case of batteries which can ramp very fast and ramp down very fast. So ramping capabilities decide how uncertainty is going to affect your performance. Again, this is like a summary of everything that I have talked about and various numerical experiments that we did. So in the previous slide, we saw that slow ramping batteries are less sensitive to uncertainties. That is the first key takeaway. That. Now, secondly, we have the compensation mechanism, like how the buying and selling prices are designed, drastically defined, is it beneficial for the for the storage owners to actually buy a battery or not? So then, prior to this work, that there are many works which claim that intermediate battery ramp rates, like So there are only three optimal rates, that's what they claim, is charging at the maximum rate, discharging at the maximum rate, and operating at zero. So these are the three states that you should opt from. And we show that this is not true. This is not always true. So, and then in the previous slide, again, we saw that the effect of uncertainty is more for batteries which are faster. It's also dependent on sampling time, which is a kind of an extension work which is going on with Lucas. And the charging and discharging efficiency, obviously buying and selling prices. So this is the summary of the first part. Any questions here? Okay, moving ahead to the second, in which we not only talk about one dedicated goal for the battery, but more than one. And what are those goals? Like in context of Madeira, I'll reiterate when the slides come, is you can do arbitrage, you can do, every home has to decide a peak power contract, you can reduce the peak power contract using the battery, then maybe you want to use the battery for backup because you know that there is electricity failures which are going to happen at certain times. So these can be different applications which you merge, and what we are trying to explore is first, are these actions, are these goals in conflict with each other? And if they are, then how much? Like suppose if I'm doing two goals, A and B, if I'm doing just A and gaining a lot and not losing a lot for B, then I should not co-optimize. So co-optimization makes only sense if I'm overall increasing my gains at the same time not reducing or incurring any penalties. So this, the motivation here is the billing, how electricity is built in different parts of the world is becoming more and more innovative. I'll give you an example of two of the power networks, one in Uruguay and other is, I think you are aware of, from Madeira. And so in this case, again, we are using two convex optimization tools with relaxations, convex relaxations like McCormick for mixed integer programming. Then there is autoregressive and model predictive. And we also take into account battery degradation, which I won't go through in this part, but in the last part of the slide. Moving ahead, the first problem, which is our first collaboration with Lucas. So this is the data for Madeira. This is the, and this, when Lucas showed me this result, I was so happy because I had an intuition that most of the PVs generate only active power and they do not generate reactive power. So they must be doing something bad with the power factor. So going to the plot, the first plot is the active power. The blue line is the active power with PV. So there is like excess generation during around 10 and the load is trying to consume most of its generation. In the reactive power, if you see, there is no fluctuation because the solar itself is not producing anything, any reactive power or consuming any reactive power. It's almost insignificant because this is of the order 400 and this is maybe minus 10 to plus 10. So what we see is the red is the power factor when people had no, this consumer had no solar, and blue is the power factor with inclusion of solar. So what we see is power factor, suppose traditionally all over the world, most of the utilities have a power factor norms that they have to maintain is around 0.9 or maybe 0.85 or 0.95, depending on how strict they are. In this case, we see that power factor violations are not happening just once, but many times in the day. And we saw our data for like 2 months, and we saw that the violations because of inclusion of solar is happening almost 10% of the total time, which is something that we cannot ignore. Now consider a lot of people having PV. Then you'll have huge problems because of PV at the transformer or substation level where they have to supply a lot of reactive power which is not even built. So the utility will lose a lot of money. So now we see, at least in France and some other countries, they are already initiating contracts in which they are billing reactive power. So the whole hypothesis is, consider a utility which is imposing some amount of penalty in maintaining reactive power. So now the goal in this context is suppose you have a battery, a consumer has a battery. Now they want to do charging and discharging arbitrage based on the price variations, or and they also have to minimize the penalty for power factor. How is that problem look like? So what happens is, in this case, so bear with me for this plot. So what does power factor mean? Power factor is a ratio of active and reactive power. Okay. So this is my x-axis is my active power, and y-axis is my reactive power. So power factor essentially is the ratio of the reactive and active. So there is a certain angle beyond which you should not go. So the feasible region in the first plot shows the ratio of active and reactive where the power factor is maintained. So this is my feasible region. Now consider the battery. Consider a battery which is operating in presence of a load. So suppose this is my load. The red star is my load, which has a power factor beyond, outside my feasible region. So my feasible region here is in green. So I would like to have a storage operating within that shaded portion. Is it clear?
Should say what for the audience? What is active?
Okay.
So active power is what you get built for. Reactive power is what gets wasted as heat in the wires. The power factor is how good your power is. So this is why you need to maximize power factor.
Yes. So just consider it like mathematically is like a complex number. So real part is the active and imaginary is the reactive. So normally you are built for only active, and there is nothing to do with reactive, because normally people used to consume energy at a very high power factor because most of the loads were resisted. So there was no need for reactive power measurement. But now it's becoming more and more crucial because you cannot ignore that aspect. Firstly, because it degrades the efficiency of the network, because if it is supplying reactive power, then you cannot use the conductors for supplying active power. So it's consuming a certain portion of your capacity, and it's not even getting paid. So it's a waste, and there are a lot of negative aspects of reactive power increasing, like voltage surges can happen. And but in this case, what we are dealing is, like, suppose you have a lot of people who are having this power factor which is close to one, close to drastically less than one, then in that case you use the battery not just for active but reactive power. So and in this case, suppose the red star is the XY plane where you have the operator is, the user is consuming, that in that case you would like to have some power factor regularization, some power factor correction. In this case, because the power factor is outside what you are allowed to. So in that case, if you have a battery, then battery has a certain capacity of supplying active and reactive power, and that intersection is the shaded region. Now the problem here is, consider that there is no load or very low load, then we have this as a feasible region, blue, shaded blue. Now if I have this as my constraint in my optimization, then this is a non-convex optimization, because basically the shape is not convex. So, but there's a trick that we can do this, formulate this as a convex optimization. If we separate it into two regions, then both these regions are convex in itself. Is it clear? So what I'm saying is, so you have this as your region, this as your feasible region, which is not convex. But if I separate it into two regions, this and this, then both of them are separately convex. And that's what we are doing using relaxations, and don't be scared with this. So we are doing a McCormick relaxation, which is, what it does is, suppose you have Z is equal to X times Y. So in this case, it's very hard to model this as a convex problem. But what you can do is, with the lower bound and upper bound, you can have four, like a shape like this. Because X will have a lower bound, Y will have a lower bound, and both of them will have an upper bound, and based on that you will have a quadrilateral which is the feasible region for this z value. And that's what we are doing here, is we have these bilinear variables x and the multiplication of two variables, and we are solving it using four different constraints, which creates a feasible region that we need to find the optimal solution in. And what happens to be is, in this case, the optimal solution is exact because one of our variables is binary. So for this case, x times y, if one of the variables is binary, then you exactly know the upper bound and lower bound, which is 0 and 1. And then for that case, we'll have an exact solution, like the McCormick relaxation is unique. Just going by the math, so P elec is the electricity price, PBI is the battery active power output, theta I is the penalty function, which I'll describe later. So battery has an active power ramping constraint, how much it can ramp and charge or discharge, which is denoted in terms of charging and discharging efficiency. Now batteries are connected to a converter, and converter has a capacity, and you cannot exceed the active and reactive power. PV square and Q is the reactive power. This constraint cannot violate the upper bound, what the rated capacity of the converter. Then theta I is max. So this is theta I. So theta I is the penalty, like this. So whenever my power factor is going beyond, like it's going away from 0.9, then I impose a penalty. If it is not, then I don't. So in that case, I represent this as two equations, which is basically a max of two terms, max of zero and the other one. Okay, and PTI is just the total active power and reactive power. So this is a work with Lucas. Okay, so what we observe is, in this formulation, both these active power and reactive power compensation are kind of decoupled. So when I'm doing arbitrage and doing power factor correction, I'm not losing anything on arbitrage, which means that both of them can be done simultaneously without any reduction for the others. And other interesting thing is, the reactive power control in itself does not require look ahead. What does I mean by look ahead is, like, suppose you are deciding reactive power compensation in the morning, you don't need to look future in time, but in active power you do. Because if you want to charge or discharge anytime, you need to see how the opportunities in future are. You cannot just decide based on that time. So there is no look ahead. And and active power requires look ahead. We also observe that the effect of uncertainty is negligible for reactive power because it does not require any look ahead. We are solving this optimization using a mixed integer convex optimization tool using Guru B and CVX on Matlab. Okay. The second formulation, which is again for partially in context of Madeira. So we are adding one more objective. So previously we had arbitrage and power factor correction. Now we are adding peak demand sharing, but not exactly in context of Madeira, but more like in context of California. So in California, PG&E, Pacific Gas and Electric, apply a peak demand charge based on the peak of what you consume over a month. Here in Madeira, you have fixed levels and you should not cross those levels. But in California, does not have fixed levels, but you are applied a fixed price similar to Madeira, but based on what your peak is over the month. So you would like to minimize the peak, because there is a peak penalty. So there is a penalty which is added, which again, the problem with this formulation is, the peak demand charge is applied for 1 month, and you do arbitrage for a day. And if you are trying to do an optimization for 1 month, then this is not probable, this is not tractable, because you will not be able to solve this optimization because it will be intractable. Now, how do we combine? The objective here is, how do we combine this different time scales so that the optimization problem becomes solvable? So what we do is, we introduce a memory variable which keeps updating based on the previous peaks. And as they find a peak which is higher than the previous peak, then you apply peak demand, otherwise you don't. So we see that we reach an optimal result using that by time scale separation and considering a memory variable and making this whole optimization tractable. So for simulations, we did like a 80-day simulation using Madeira data, applying different charges from California and CAISO. Again, applying uncertainty based using model predictive control. So I'll show you just one result for co-optimization. So before we go to the results, we see this is just for arbitrage. This is arbitrage versus power factor correction. This is everything together. This is peak, only peak demand. This is arbitrage plus peak demand. Now we have four different batteries. Five different batteries. And what we see, this is my total gain. I'll just focus on the yellow for now. What we see is the total gain for co-optimization is significantly higher than doing anything at a time. So in fact, if you see 4C, the top battery, what happens is if you are doing like the negative, there are some gains which are going in the negative direction below x-axis. What it means is if you are doing just one thing, that then you are increasing the penalty in the other drastically, which means that just looking one goal is a very bad thing because you might screw up other objectives and you may have to pay much more. So co-optimization makes sense two ways, because it increases the overall gains. Secondly, you avoid penalties which you might incur if you consider only one objective at a time, or maybe few objectives at a time and not everything together. Any questions? Yeah.
So the y-axis is cost, right?
The y-axis is the profit.
And the profit there, is it actual profit, economic money, or?
Yeah, so profit is like, so suppose if you had no battery, what you would have paid, and with battery, what you would have paid.
How come the power factor correction increases your profit?
So in this case, we have a cost, like not just a hypothetical penalty, but it's like translated into a number.
Okay.
So yeah, it makes sense. I did not describe because otherwise it's not possible to tell everything. So yeah. Okay. Third one is interesting because it's for Madeira. So here we are doing three things. Here we are doing more than three things. We are doing arbitrage, we are doing peak demand savings, we are doing a backup, like considering that there could be a power failure sometimes. Two types. First, you know that it's going to happen sometimes. Like you get a call that at 7 p.m. tomorrow, there's going to be a power cut. And secondly, you don't know something which is going to happen, but you know a probability of something happening. So based on the probability and an actual outage time, how do I control my battery? So the first thing, so theta I is, BLEC is the electricity price. H is my sample time, because billable part is only the energy, which is, and theta is basically this. I don't know whether it's visible. Theta is max of zero. What I mean here is, whenever my, so this is my total load, including the storage output. Whenever they are greater than zero, then only I'm getting paid. I have to pay. If it is like below zero, which means that I'm supplying power back to the grid, but I get nothing, because that's what it does. And lambda here is the penalty, like and which is associated with a probability. Suppose I have a power failure probability, something like this. So which is a high probability of failure, power failure during morning hours and during evening. Then I would like to maintain more charge level during those periods, because I know that power may go. And I have four couple of constraints, the battery ramping constraint, capacity constraint, and theta I in 3 and 4, so denotes this. So whenever I'm right, theta I greater than this, 0, and greater than Li, then it means that max of 0 in Li. Then fifth one is the PPC constraint. So I have a PPC, and I do not want to violate the PPC, otherwise I'll have electricity cut. And sixth one is, suppose I know that there is a power incident which is going to happen, then my battery capacity should be higher than my expected limit, like suppose 80% of my charge. So these are 4 or 5 goals. And what we observe is, considering, so this can be formulated as, again, as a convex optimization problem, which is nice because we can guarantee optimality. We also consider battery cycle degradation, and we observe that for a simple battery, a payback period of approximately 3 years, which is very reasonable, much more beneficial than even California. So numerical results indicate that, again, the same conclusions, ramping capability decides the peak demand charges, how much I can save. We also observe that co-optimization is good for consumers and not taking any one at a time. For DG, for suppose homes which have a source of generator, generation is higher than inelastic load, then, so what I mean is, suppose somebody has a PV which is higher than the load, in that case, batteries can contribute to self-sufficiency. Otherwise, we observe that batteries do not increase the self-sufficiency of the home. The formulation is used to recommend, we also recommend for the best contract for the consumer based on the numerical results and the gains that the consumer is making. And there are a lot of consumer contracts in Madeira, we have 48. I did a case study for Uruguay, and which is interesting is because this kind of covers all kind of contracts. So let's say pricing type. So normally we see two types of pricing in which the prices are actually varying. The first one is real-time pricing, and the second one, like for Madeira, it's time of use. Now, and there are two types of compensation mechanism. Consider equal buying and selling, like many parts in the world, and unequal buying and selling, like here in Madeira, in which you have selling price zero. So based on these four criteria, what happens is you have four different types of cases. And based on these cases, we can identify what are the parameters that will affect my storage action. And what happens, and which is very interesting, is Uruguay falls in the first category, in which the buying and selling prices are the same, and they have a time of use prices. So what it means is, when you are trying to use the battery, you don't need to look ahead. You just need to set your pre-decided optimal solutions, and those you can guarantee that they will be optimal because nothing is affecting. There is no uncertainty in your actions, which is the cool case. But for us here, we are in third case, in which we'll have in our storage action, we'll have uncertainty because of the load and the renewable generation. But I wanted to give a whole picture, but okay. So moving to the third part, in which we are doing some high-level applications for the utility. I'll discuss three applications. In this, we are using localized Markovian dynamics, centralized stochastic control. We are doing stability analysis, doing some convex optimization, and using some network-based simulations for radial distribution control. The first problem is control of flip of batteries. So suppose there are a lot of batteries which are scattered in a region, like consider Madeira, and these batteries are not communicating among themselves, and the grid wants to control the battery in a such a way that they want to track some imbalance. Suppose you have this reference signal, which is the mismatch between supply and demand. And the grid wants all these batteries to track this. So they send a control signal to all these batteries. And the batteries decide what to do. And all these batteries are not interacting among themselves. So how do we control? And the second aspect is, like suppose this signal is drifting downwards. Like if you take the mean, then suppose it's drifting downwards. In that case, how do you control, maintain the SOC? We'll deal with that later, but for now, suppose I have to track this reference signal accurately with a fleet of batteries with stochastic control, And these controls have a localized controller and a centralized controller. So the centralized controller sends a scalar signal to all the batteries. And these batteries are deciding what to do based on some Markovian dynamics. So here, you need to take care of a few dynamics. Is the battery should not be charged beyond a certain extent, because for lithium ions, it will be a bomb if you overcharge it. And you cannot discharge it below a certain level, because otherwise your life of batteries will be very, very high, very, very reduced. So you don't want overuse also, because you want to increase the idle time, the batteries in which, the time in which the batteries are doing nothing, you want to increase that period. So, and stochastic solution happens to be a nice approach to deal with this, is because normally we would like the solution to be scalable. If it is not stochastic, the solution will not be scalable. And a randomized controller for this case is making this possible. So we have, again, reiterating, we have a distributed control architecture with an outer error feedback loop, in which the aggregated power output of all these batteries is being tracked to some reference signal and a local decision loop. So I'm not going in detail with in the controller, but what I wanted to show is, so the blue line shows how the batteries would have performed if we had exact information. And the red is basically what we are achieving with the stochastic control. So as you can see that for these four different cases in which you have efficiency losses and asymmetrical ramp rates, we observe that the gap between the red and the blue line lies within under 4%, which means that are myopic and we are not even looking ahead. So these decisions are made every 2 seconds and without any look ahead. And we reach to an optimality level of optimality gap of less than 4%. And this happens to be our motivation to extend some work with Lucas, which I'll talk in future slides. In this slide. So this is my second application. So utilities are increasing the reserves. So what reserves mean is these are very, very fast responsive resources which try to maintain the gap between demand and supply. So for this case, for EEM, they are concerned if a 10 megawatt wind turbine all of a sudden stops working because there is no wind, then what should they do? Because they need some resources to come into picture and try to not make the grid crash. Like this is a case for which country? This is, I think, Belgium. So this is all of a sudden we observe that there is a loss in generator and almost a 15% dip. So if you see, there's a 15% dip happening in few seconds, and there is no way any utility can deal with a situation like this. So the load is not varying at all. The load is steady, but this is the generators and the imbalance percentage with respect to the load. So the supply and demand imbalance is huge, because one generator failed all of a sudden, and because of that I have a huge imbalance. Now, should I design my reserves? Should I design my resources based on this situation? No way, because this will cost me billions of dollars. So what should we do is, we should bring a reliability context in my optimization setup, so that we can deal with a situation and say that integration of storage will deal us or improve the reliability by say 0.5% or a measurable number, which we found that was non-existent. And what we did is, these networks have a sustainability. Like for Madeira, because it's an island network, the ability to sustain fluctuations is much lower, because there's something called as response or inertia of the network, which is significantly lower compared to say France as a network, because it's a huge network connected with other networks. There is Belgium, Spain, there are other networks to support. So the overall inertia or ability to sustain fluctuation is much higher. So in this plot here, we see that we are kind of simplifying the problem, but this simplification comes from basic power system theory. What it means is that the green region is like the, I don't want to balance between supply and demand all the time exactly. I want to keep the imbalance in somewhere in this feasible region. And when I decide this feasible region, we can formulate this optimization problem again as a convex optimization using some simplification. So this is an ongoing project. We recently submitted it, and we did a couple of case studies for Europe and one for US. And there are a few interesting observations. Is this storage as a resource degrades as you increase the storage size, because the ability that the marginal improvement in reliability reduces as you make the storage larger and larger, which makes sense. So there will be a cutoff when for all these planning planners, for power system planners, they will have to pick up a benchmark or an upper threshold where they can cut and say, okay, this is my up to this marginal value, I'll invest. After that, I won't. So yeah, we also propose a myopic controller, which could be implemented in real time without any look ahead, and it's a work in progress. So this is the plot I was trying to show. So the reliability, so is as the storage is increasing. This is in context of Belgium. So as my storage is increasing, so first 100 megawatt, I have like 0.3% increase in reliability. But as I keep increasing the battery size, I don't see the same amount of improvement in reliability, which makes sense. But now we can at least do a measurable thing and say that, okay, the first 100 megawatt has this amount of potential. The third is phase balancing. This again started with some data from Madeira, which Lucas showed me in context of a power system in a substation. I think it's getting too much. Maybe I'll just skip it. So what we are trying to do is a lot of DGs and EVs are coming. Distributed generators or electric vehicles. And most of them are single phase. So suppose what will happen if you connect a lot of single phase EVs or DGs in a network in one phase? That can happen accidentally because these are randomized decisions, and a lot of people may connect to one phase and all the load is going to one phase. So what will happen is one phase will be heavily loaded and the two other phases are lightly loaded, or vice versa. So in that case, your three-phase system gets distorted, and there are a lot of losses which are coming up. In our simulations, we observe that there is neutral losses and the conductor may blow up, or the phase losses which will increase drastically. Then there are quality indices like voltage quality will deteriorate. And suppose you have a transformer or three-phase devices like induction motor, then the life of the device over time decreases. So you need to maintain. So like for example, now EEM in Madeira is considering suppose they install the battery, what should they use for? So this is one possible application in which they can not only use it for other applications, but balance the three phases if there is any imbalance. So we present two case studies, one for EV charging in Pasadena in California, and other is for the substation in Madeira. These are the three solutions that we provide. So suppose you have a battery, you want to connect into one of the phases. So this is one solution. You can have three batteries dedicated to three phases. This is the solution which EEM is applying in the substation. And the third is like you have three batteries, but you want to select which battery to connect to which phase. So this is again under review. Just walking high level to the third final part of my presentation, the health part, in which we consider a lithium-ion battery, and we use the degradation model, and we develop some algorithms and some controller stability identification. Like if anyone is aware, linear quadratic regulator in this case. So don't look at the slide. So the first the problem here is the batteries have a limited life. So what we want to do is we want to model the life, and we wish to come up with a definition which is not chemical in a sense, because I consider myself partially a mathematician. I should see numbers. I don't want to see chemical life. So almost all data sheets have two things: the calendar life of the battery and the cycle life of the battery. Now, how can we use these to model the battery? So our hypothesis, which is not my original hypothesis, but I'm aligning myself with some previous work, is the calendar life of the battery should be matched with the battery life. So suppose my battery is degrading in its life by 10% in 1 year, then the number of cycles that I should perform should cause 10% of degradation. Then I'm maximizing my life, because then my battery will last for 10 years. If I'm using, say, not 400 cycles, but 1,000 cycles, then my battery will last only 3 years, and I won't be able to use it for the whole life. So I should use the battery so that its length of the life is maximized over time. We present an algorithm. So there is something called as depth of discharge, which I should explain you here. Is suppose my battery is like this, and I charge start from here, I go to here and come back here. This is one cycle, right? So I charge my battery and I discharge to the same level. So this is one cycle. The second case is I start from here, I go to here, and I go here. So what is the difference between both these cycles is called as depth of discharge. So depth of discharge is the difference between, so this is my depth of discharge. Now the tricky thing is this depth of discharge is not linear. What I mean is, so this is my depth of discharge, and the number of cycles the battery can perform over life. So this is the data taken from a data sheet. So if I assume that 10 cycles of 10% DOD is equal to 1 cycle of 100% DOD, that's not true. And that is because of the green line. So if I assume a linear relationship between DOD and the cycles of operation, then it's like a grave underestimation of my battery life. Because I can perform much many number of smaller cycles over time compared to bigger cycles of over the time. Is it clear? So what I mean is, suppose this is my 10% change in SOC, and say this is 100% change in SOC. So 10 cycles of such operation is not equal to one cycle of this. This is much lower. What I mean is, if you do smaller cycles, your battery lasts longer. That is based on the lithium chemistry. So if we model that with a non-linear model, we find that can be fit with a blue line below. So again, that model is not developed by me, but someone else. And we are using the same model here. And we use this degradation model to count the number of cycles, because the cycle life of the battery is well defined. So cycle life, again, controlling the cycles of operation is governed by what application I'm talking about. Am I talking about arbitrage, or am I talking about something else? So it will be designed based on that. For example, this is one example that I'm showing is, suppose the first plot is the price of electricity, which is varying over time. So there is a peak in the morning, and there is a peak in the evening. This is for New York ISO. And in this case, if I have to use the battery, then I can reduce the number of cycles. So these are all ramping rates, charging and discharging rates of the battery based on certain friction. So we have included a friction in mode changes. And based on that, if you see the profit is not reducing drastically, but the number of cycles that I'm performing is reducing drastically. So for the first case, I have a profit of 10 cents for a 1 kilowatt-hour battery, and I'm performing almost more than 2.5 cycles. And for this case, in which my friction coefficient is 0.7 and the battery is almost not performing, I mean, it's only charging and discharging very few times, I'm gaining almost 6 cents, which is like a 40% reduction, but almost 200% reduction in how many cycles I perform. So what I intend to say is, based on this mechanism that we propose, we can control the cycles of operation by only eliminating the low returning transactions. Obviously, you are going to lose something, but you only lose the low returning transactions. And like for here, so this plot, so definitely I should discharge my battery when my peak is jumping, right? Because I don't want to miss that peak. And definitely I should discharge when the peak is there. So these are like high returning transactions, because the difference in prices below around 16 and after 16 is huge. So I should not miss that peak. So what I'm saying is, by limiting by this friction coefficient, you lose something, but you lose only the bad part of the charging and discharging cycle. Any question? Okay. So the second part is, again, I was talking about controlling of a fleet of batteries. Then you have a lot of batteries. Now, there's a big problem. So that was my paper in 2017. Now, recently we realized that there is a big flaw in that paper, is that cannot sustain, that you cannot sustain it for long times, because eventually your battery SOC will degrade to zero and you won't be able to charge or discharge. Because if I'm giving commands, so you need to take care of the SOC of the battery charge level over the time so that you can use it for sustainably longer period of time. So instead of having only one goal in which I'm tracking a regulation signal, I should have two goals, not just one goal. And the second goal is to maintain the charge of SOC. So when I have two goals, then it becomes complex, because when to prioritize, how to put more weight on something and less weight on something. So I'm using a LQR, which is linear quadratic regulator, which is meant for something like this, in which you have multi-objective problem and you are trying to stabilize the controller, because sometimes what will happen is maintaining SOC comes in conflict with tracking. Then what should we do? And this is again scheduling plot. Is suppose my mean SOC is here, so the SOC of all the fleet is close to zero, then my proportional controller gain is not steady, it's not linear. So the red is the linear line, but what I'm saying is, as my SOC is drifting farther away, you should increase, you should put more importance to maintaining SOC than on actually tracking. So what we observe using this is, when we use this as a controller, we expect the performance to deteriorate, right? Because we are doing two objectives rather than one objective. So, and using some standard norms, like PGM is one of the ISO. So we want to see how badly we are affecting our performance. And we observe that we don't see any visible change. What it means is we can do both these objectives simultaneously without hurting the other. So this is kind of considering the health aspect of the battery. Okay, so I would like to acknowledge all my mentors and collaborators. Lucas is here, and there are other people that I have worked with during my PhD, including my supervisor in the talk. And yeah, thanking you for, I have already given all these conclusions during my individual parts. I'll reiterate, so this thesis was on storage and optimization of control and optimization of batteries, considering different problems in power network. We present computationally efficient solutions using tools such as convex optimization, randomized stochastic control, and threshold-based optimal policies. We do several case studies here, and we also consider battery, lithium-ion battery life and its limitations. So what we expect is, as the systems are becoming more and more volatile, we consider this work to be going to be even more relevant in future. Thank you.
The probability you are using, is it from technical data or is it just assumed?
Yeah, I assumed it. Because there was no data. I tried to ask
because... Yeah, because you have failure rate within 4 years. Like, I think I only have 3 times the power failure in here.
My objective was to formulate it mathematically. And considering... So we tried to do the number calculation as you indicated, but we could not. Because he did not have enough information.
It's too low, like you said.
Yeah.
It's like almost none.
That's true. So we assumed it at the end.
And another thing is, like, you are actually making a single objective by adding all of the objectives to this.
So in this case, it's more intuitive. It's because all of these individual objectives translate something in terms of money. Like, so they have a single unit. In many cases, that is not possible, because you might have to select a penalty factor. And now, how will you prioritize one objective over other, which might be a tricky thing. But in this case, it's more simple, is because each of these objectives are already associated with money. So if there is a power factor violation, then I translate that into money and you don't have to select the penalty factor. Because otherwise, it might be something more priority, something less.
So when you are actually calculating the battery cycle, you are taking the time, its life cycle, and how many times it can charge per day. So at the end, you are like, considering the various light and how you actually convert that light and to the money?
There are a bunch of papers on that.
Because they are like initially it was the like in a time cycle.
So this is exactly the presentation I gave to one company interview recently. Yeah, this translates based on So I was talking about cycle life and calendar life, right? So you have different models and you consider this as a model. And there is some intuition behind why you consider. So we consider max, the third model we consider. So which is the max of how much cycle operational degradation you are incurring to the battery and with the age of the battery. And this is a simple model that we propose. So how battery manufacturers decide the life of the battery is based on your rated capacity reducing to 80% of its initial capacity. That's how you normally define lithium-ion battery life. So I define mathematically the same thing here in terms of the cycles that the battery operate, which is denoted here, and the cycle life, and the time, the age of the battery, and the age of the calendar life of the battery. And it's getting reduced to 0.2. So does that answer your question, or how that translates into money is, I'll show you.
So you just give us like every day how much money, like value is depreciated, like the battery's value is depreciated per day?
No, not per day. So you accumulate it over time, like because the degradation in one day is almost 1 by 365, so it's very, very small. So I don't do it one day, so what I'll show you is, consider this as an example in which you have simulation results for 1 year, I think. This is one day. So you have the dollars per cycle. What it means is how many dollars I am gaining per cycle that I operate.
Based on the final resolution.
Yes. Because that makes sense, because otherwise I cannot compare one application to other.
Yeah, because it's also the harmony cycle.
Suppose I'm getting $10 by operating 100 cycles and $10 by operating one cycle. You cannot compare. I mean, both of them look same in dollars, but they are not the same. If I have to do a lot of work to do the same money, and if I do nothing and get the same money, it's the same analogy, I would say. Like here, if I say two different applications for battery, one for arbitrage and other for the utility scale regulation. So you see, you earn like 5 cents or 6 cents in the top, and you earn like $1 in the bottom, which is 20 times higher than the top.